I'm Gordon Smith. I am a psychic medium.
I see, hear, and sense the spirit world that surrounds us all. My gift means that I can tune into people's destiny, reconnect the spirit world with this one, and help those in need. Each week, I meet a top British celebrity for a very special one-to-one psychic reading. This week, I'm talking to controversial singer, songwriter, and 1980s fashion icon, Pete Burns. Pete's extraordinary appearance on Celebrity Big Brother gripped the nation.
The coat's been arrested,
and I want that coat back within the next 2 hours.
Back in the 1980s, Pete was the lusted after lead singer of Dead or Alive. But a dissatisfaction with his looks led him to an obsession with plastic surgery.
Makeup washes off, so why not have something that doesn't wash off?
Which saw him change his face beyond recognition over the next 20 years. This obsession led to disaster when an operation to increase the size of his lips went horribly wrong.
He held me down on a table, he pierced it, and cups of yellow fluid came out. But he didn't give me a diagnosis, and it just went from bad to worse.
But behind the outrageous looks and the caustic wit is a very different Pete, whose turbulent past has made him the man he is today.
I didn't really have a childhood.
His mother suffered from depression, drug and alcohol dependency throughout his childhood, and attempted suicide several times, often when the young Pete was home alone.
I heard some sound that was just wrong. I pushed everything away from the door upstairs and she'd sliced her wrists open and the veins were hanging out.
Over 2 extraordinary days, I was able to give Pete a psychic reading. It was a revelation to both him and me. Finally, I begin to understand what has made this man into the person we know today. I got to be your friend now, baby. And I would like to move in just a little bit. Pete Burns is one of the most controversial characters in British music, but I believe he has a strong spiritual side to his personality. I went to meet him at his London home to see what I could pick up from the atmosphere around him.
Pete, I absolutely love your home and also the sense of peace that you feel in it here.
It's kind of fancy, isn't it?
It's fantastic. It really reflects you, I think.
I think we're like Russian dolls in a lot of ways. We have a lot of layers, and I was very aware of that from an early age. What you see on the outside is certainly not what is on the inside.
That's what I feel. Just sitting with you, I can almost feel the different layers of your life and around you, and even in the spirit world, I feel different people around you at different times of your life.
I wish they'd make themselves visible.
The feeling I get from this place tells me that your mother is actually very much around you just now, and especially currently. I feel as though she's been trying to give you signs and information in current times.
I'm very aware of her presence right now. I'm not like Norman Bates in Psycho, who I've idolised as my mother, because as far as parental skills go in the conventional world, she certainly wasn't a mother. I mean, she's the best human being that I've ever had the privilege of being in the company of. And I know that she had a special plan for me. She's called me Star Baby.
Yeah.
And she knew that there was something special in me. Just an incredible German woman, tiny, 5'1", but she could move a wardrobe. She could lift a wardrobe. Mm-hmm. I grew up until I was 5 speaking German and a bit of French. There was no English spoken in my house. My father spoke to my mother in French. She spoke to me in German.
Pete's mother, Eva, was the daughter of a German-Jewish film director, Hugh Quitner, and his wife, Maria. She attended silent film school and planned to follow her family into the film business. But the Second World War was to set the beautiful young Eva on a very different path.
She had an incredible cultural background and she decided I was not going to have formal education because what good would the Battle of Hastings do me in life? And she encouraged me to create and create and create, and there were no boundaries and there was no male or female. She was right into there's no gender. and a skirt doesn't make a man, and all of these things. So I grew up in a completely open and free environment, which a lot of people think causes problems in life. Well, guess what? It did. But yeah. Those problems make you stronger.
But I'll tell you what, I don't think your mother's ever far away from you.
I wish she'd make herself known.
Yeah. Oh, she does. She absolutely does. Do you know the lovely thing, and I hope you will know this, I've just seen this most beautiful, beautiful picture of a place that looks like... It looks like something out of Hansel and Gretel.
That'll be Salzburg, where she fled to in the war,
do you know
maybe.
What? It actually feels like something like that, almost. But there's such a lot of mountains in the backdrop.
Salzburg, yeah. Where her sister lived. I've seen it already. I've been there.
Have you?
Yeah.
Because that just came into my mind, even as you were talking about your mother, and just this feeling of the amount of, if you like, Germanic connections.
When war broke out, Eva's Jewish father was forced into hiding, but was betrayed by the family chauffeur and died later in a Nazi concentration camp. Eva then went on the run with her mother and eventually met Pete's father, a British soldier, at a soldier's tea dance in Vienna.
She denied she was German. I found that on her passport she claimed to be Austrian because she was so ashamed of what the Germans had done in the Nazi occupation. She was a German Jew, and I didn't know that until many years later. Until I found her passport where she was born, because she said she was born in Salzburg, and she wasn't actually. She was born in Heidelberg, and then she lived in Berlin.
But I actually feel as though a lot of your mother is in you. That somebody like that who's so close to you can't actually die. They dissolve into your heart.
I appreciate that.
But I would assume that you're all, even as I look at you and as a medium, I actually almost see your face changing into your mother. And I've never seen a picture of your mother.
That's a bit spooky.
I do.
I've always had an incredible resemblance to her. My eyes are the same physically. I'm built the same. And I never said to a surgeon, make me look like mommy.
So how did the whole cosmetic surgery thing start?
Well, I think from a very early age, I just kind of was very intrigued in that kind of... I thought makeup washes off. So why not have something that doesn't wash off? Yeah. And I didn't know much. It was a long journey.
Pete started having cosmetic surgery in 1985, when his desire for the perfect lips led to a disastrous choice. A permanent solution was injected into his lips to increase their size. It was a chemical to which his body reacted badly. It poisoned his bloodstream, and what followed nearly cost him his life.
One day I did a show with the Scissor Sisters and I was in pain, quite bad actually, but I didn't say anything. And after the gig, I woke up and my lower lip was, I mean, honestly, it's not a sort of, to say it was that big, that a bit, and I called him and he came back from Birmingham and he saw me and he held me down on a table, he pierced it and cups of yellow fluid came out. But he didn't give me a diagnosis and it just went from bad to worse. And eventually, holes were appearing in the face and I'd touch my face and it would hiss and yellow stuff would ejaculate from the face. Yeah. But I mean, this is not ill. I'd leave it on the mirror because no one could believe it was coming out of my face, and I was searching for doctors for an answer. And quite by chance, I told my webmaster, Rose Keefe, why I'd disappeared. And she said, but there's a plastic surgeon on the Right Stuff website, which is my website. And she contacted him. His name was Paolo and he worked for an eminent surgeon in Genoa, Italy, who's a cancer reconstructive surgeon, and he spoke no English, and this wonderful woman called Marina, who's a professor of the English school in Genoa, she didn't know me, and she flew over with him to translate, and she said, you're coming to Italy, you're coming to my house, this is what he's going to do. And I went to Italy thinking I'd get four operations, but when he opened me up, he found the stuff had migrated all over the face and neck area, and he thought four operations, and it ended up like I was there 18 months, and it's ongoing for life, really.
In part two, Pete tells me about his 2 years of painful reconstructive surgery.
Two major surgeries a week to save my life, not just my face.
And I also get a chance to see inside his wardrobe to view his incredible clothing collection. Barnes was a leading light on the new romantic scene of the late 1980s with his group Dead or Alive. But a dissatisfaction with his appearance led him to experiment with plastic surgery. Over the next 20 years, he had numerous operations until a procedure to enlarge his lips went horribly wrong. Pete was injected with a chemical that poisoned his bloodstream and disfigured his face. What followed was a nightmare 18 months of major surgery to rebuild his looks.
Only days after